Alright guys, we are back in my garage for another video, and I'm going to say a lot of things today. Things like the AFR readings in your logs aren't accurate, or the O2 sensor after your catalytic converter does affect your fueling. I'll say a lot of stuff that you'll probably disagree with at first, but the good news is I'm going to share with you the facts and information I found in my research to explain why things work the way they are, and give you a little bit more insight on how your O2 sensors are functioning. So this is going to be that video that shares way more information than you probably ever need, but I guarantee you'll be happy that you listened and stuck around for the whole story, because this is going to help you be able to diagnose problems and just work through logs and setting up your car to get exactly what you want out of it. So let's go ahead and talk about it. Now, as always, for everybody that's new to the channel, I create these videos to help keep you updated on the latest developments in our community, as well as discuss technical topics so that we have a better understanding of how our engines work. So if you're interested in more videos like that, be sure to subscribe, because there will be a lot more coming out in the future. So the O2 and O2 sensor stands for oxygen, and like a lot of you probably guessed, an oxygen sensor measures oxygen, but it's probably not as simple as you think. Yes, it does have holes in the base, but it's not just taking in oxygen and measuring it through that sensor. What's actually happening is the oxygen sensor, for all intents and purposes, is a hollow tube. Inside of that hollow tube, it has a sensing element, and that sensing element is made of a material that promotes the flow of oxygen across its path. So when it's mounted on your exhaust, you're going to have exhaust flowing by on one side, but the other side of the hollow tube allows ambient air to come in contact with the other facing surface of that sensing element. Now, the delta of oxygen content between your exhaust gas and the ambient air is going to promote oxygen flow across that sensor. And as oxygen flows across it, it changes the voltage in the sensor, which is sent to the DME, and the DME is able to determine how much oxygen is in your exhaust gas. So this is the first thing that I think a lot of people need to note, is that your O2 sensor is not measuring AFR. What it's measuring is the ratio between oxygen in your exhaust gas and oxygen in the ambient air, and your DME is using that in a way to calculate the AFRs. Now, the good thing is this is a ratio. It's something that's always going to be, you know, this versus that. It's not just a set number or measuring a certain amount of oxygen. And that's really important, because if you know how air-fuel ratios work, you know that there is a stoichiometric number where you have the perfect mix of air and fuel to completely have an efficient combustion process. So for pump gas, that's 14.7 to 1. So 14.7 units of air and 1 unit of pump gas should be a full complete burn and give you the most efficient burning possible. So if we're only using this ratio with our O2 sensor, it completely eliminates that variation, because at the end of the day, all you care about is the proportion of oxygen in the ambient air and oxygen in the exhaust gas. And at that stoichiometric ratio where you have the perfect burn, you're going to have the same amount of oxygen coming out of your exhaust. So that's why it doesn't measure AFRs, it actually measures lambda. Now, lambda is a calculation of that ratio between fuel and air to say that it's a perfect mix. So if you've got that stoichiometric ratio, then the mix is lambda 1. That's your perfect mix where you don't have any excess fuel or air coming out of your exhaust. Now, if it runs rich, you have a little bit of extra fuel, the number is going to drop. So it might go down to 0.9 or 0.8 on the lambda scale. If it's running lean, the number will go up. So it'll go to 1.1 or 1.2. So it's able to measure a wide range of AFRs in a lot of applications. But by using the lambda scale, you eliminate any issues with variation of running pump gas or E85 or E30, E50, whatever it is, it's always going to measure in lambda. So this is another point I want to touch on, because some of you guys have reached out to me and said, hey, you know, on my pump gas map and I'm cruising around or at idle, it's running 14.7 to 1. But when I switch to E85, my logs still show 14.7 to 1. Isn't that a little bit lean? But again, I'll go back to my point that O2 sensors don't measure AFR. So what we're actually seeing in your logs is a calculation on the AFR scale for pump gas. So really, your sensor is reading lambda 1. Regardless of whether it's E85, E50, pump gas, whatever it is, it's reading lambda 1 at idle, but your log is converting it to 14.7. So generally what I say is, if you see AFRs in your logs that are safe for pump gas, it should be safe for E85 as well, because the car is automatically adjusting for whatever fuel you're running. Now, the last thing I'll just touch on quickly is that your O2 sensor has to be up to temperature in order for it to measure accurately. So this means that it needs to be literally over 700 to 1000 degrees Fahrenheit, which is pretty common for your exhaust to get up to that temperature, but it takes some time. So on older cars, it was pretty common to let exhaust gas heat up your O2 sensor. But over time, we started seeing integrated heaters in the O2 sensor so that it would heat up more quickly and be able to give you accurate readings more quickly. So that's something that pretty much all O2 sensors we use have integrated. Now, there are two types of O2 sensors. The first one is a narrow band. And as far as I'm aware, this is still the most common O2 sensor being used today. And the reason is because one, it's very simple, and two, because it can very accurately measure lambda one. So the reason why they call it a narrow band sensor is because it has a very narrow window where it can measure accurately, and it would be like 14.6 to 14.8 AFR, or 0.99 up to 1.01 lambda. So it's able to measure that very accurately based on how the sensor is designed. But outside of that range, it's virtually useless. It has too many AFR readings that land on the voltage it's giving out, so it can't accurately tell you the difference between, you know, 12 and 14 AFR. All it can tell you is that it's rich and you need to reduce how much fuel you're putting in the car to get it back closer to lambda one. Now, of course, it's also used to measure CAD efficiency. So on our cars being the downstream O2 sensor, it's installed after the catalytic converter, and it's able to measure the reduced amount of oxygen after airflow goes through the CAD. So it's still measuring oxygen content by measuring that ratio between exhaust gases and the ambient air, but the car is expecting to see less oxygen at that point because some of it does get consumed and, you know, changed inside of the catalytic converter. So as long as that is showing that the catalytic converter is operating effectively, then it should keep your check engine light off and you should be able to pass any emissions test and continue driving your car. This also explains why an O2 spacer can help alleviate issues if you're running like a high flow cat or a catless downpipe, because it's expecting a reduced amount of oxygen in the airflow. And if you're not seeing that because you don't have a catalytic converter, it can throw a code. So if you add an O2 spacer just to pull it a little bit out of the way of the direct exhaust flow, that should hopefully reduce how much oxygen is making it to the O2 sensor so that it will tell the computer that your catalytic converter is working effectively. So that's all good and dandy for low load and cruising around town, but if you're going wide open throttle, it probably doesn't seem like a good idea to ignore what your O2 sensor is reading. You probably want a sensor that can actually tell you how rich the car is running so that you can accurately dial it in and let the car respond to whatever fueling you're putting in. And that's where a wideband sensor comes into play. So this is a sensor that's a little bit more complicated than a narrowband sensor because it integrates an O2 pump. And what the O2 pump does is it controls how much airflow is going over the sensing element. And by adding the capability to manipulate airflow over the sensing element, you're able to accurately measure lambda readings across a much wider scale. So usually what I see is on the low end, it's able to measure as rich as 0.7 lambda. And on the high end, it's able to get up to 1.3 lambda. So on the pump gas scale, that would be as low as around 10.3 AFR or as high as about 19.1 AFR. So that's definitely a much wider range than 14.6 to 14.8 or 0.99 to 1.01 lambda. Now you're able to see exactly how rich the car is running. And this is what comes factory on our cars. We call it an upstream sensor, sensor one, you know, pre-cat sensor, a bunch of different names, but it's the one that's closest to the turbo. Now, a lot of older cars or other cars that just come with narrowband sensors will end up adding this onto their car in order to safely tune it. So that's also a really common feature. If it's still staying in a mode where it doesn't react to the O2 sensor, or you don't have an ECU or DME that can add it in so that it can control fueling, you might just add a gauge in the car so that you can see what your AFRs are and you know that it's safe. And of course, when you're tuning it, you can see it and manipulate fueling to keep it in a safe range. So not as ideal, but other people do take advantage of it, even if your car doesn't come with one. Now, the last thing I want to talk about are fuel trims, because this is where all the magic really comes together. No matter how perfect your tune is, you're going to run into a scenario where it's slightly warmer outside or cooler outside, the air is more or less dense, DA is going to vary day to day, even in the same day, so you need a car that can adjust. And that's where fuel trims come into play. We've got two different fuel trims, short-term and long-term, and both of these are dependent on how much fuel is actually going into the engine compared to what you want your Lambda reading to be. So if the car sees that it's running richer than it should be based on your Lambda reading, it's going to pull a little bit of fuel, and that's what your fuel trims are doing. So your short-term is making really small, immediate changes as the car drives. Your long-term fuel trim is making a larger adjustment based on average fuel deltas over a period of time. So both of these are very important to not only make sure that the car is being able to reach your target AFRs, but also reducing how much it needs to adjust on the fly. If you just floor it from a stoplight, you don't want it to be completely out of whack and taken off guard. These fuel trims will help make sure that at a baseline, it's much closer to where it should be, and then it can make small adjustments as you go through the rev range. Now, I'll be the first to admit that I've inaccurately said in the past that your downstream O2 sensor is what controls your fuel trims. That's not entirely accurate. What it does control is what your AFR readings are going to be at idle from your upstream sensor. The reason is because, again, that downstream narrowband sensor is very accurate when it's reading Lambda at idle or low load. If you're looking for Lambda 1, your narrowband sensor is going to give you the most detail to make sure you're as close as possible. Whereas the wideband, it's able to see a wide range, but it can't make those small adjustments all the time. Also, your wideband sensor is the closest one to your engine, the closest one to your turbo, so it sees the harshest conditions. It sees a lot of pressure, a lot of heat, a lot of really high-speed airflow, so it's the one that tends to go out of whack the quickest. So what your car can do is use your narrowband readings to calibrate your upstream sensor when you're at idle and low load. It makes sure that it should be reading Lambda 1 in those scenarios, and if it's not, it's making those calibration adjustments so that you can get the longest life out of your upstream sensor. So what a lot of people experience is if they disconnect their downstream sensor, or if their downstream sensor stops working for some reason, the fuel trims will start to drift because the O2 readings from your upstream sensor will start to drift. So it starts thinking that it's running richer and richer and richer, or leaner and leaner and leaner over time, and your fuel trims will keep trying to adjust to keep things in check. But really it's your upstream O2 sensor that's drifting, and it doesn't have the narrowband sensor to calibrate it. So this is why you can't just delete or remove your downstream O2 sensor when you install a catless downpipe, or if you're running a big turbo setup and you think, okay, I'll just leave this off. You can't do that. What you're going to see in your tune is sometimes you're able to disable the catalytic converter efficiency codes when you run a catless downpipe, but that still keeps the secondary O2 sensor active, and you can still get diagnostic codes if your downstream O2 sensor stops working. The only thing that's disabled in your tune is the code for that specific monitor that's checking if your catalytic converter is working. So again, all of this to say you still need the downstream O2 sensor. It does control your fueling, and it makes sure that your upstream O2 sensor is doing its job, so all of your fuel trims and everything are accurate and you're keeping your car safe. So yeah, I don't know how long this video is going to end up being, but I really just wanted to cover all of these details because I feel like it's good information. And after doing a lot more research and getting more grounded in what the downstream O2 sensor does and how Lambda works and all that, I felt like a lot more people should know this, because it's hard to find good information out there. And I know a lot of people will probably still want to argue, so I welcome the conversation as always. But other than that, I think that's it for this video. So thank you guys for watching, and I hope this helps. And if you do have any other questions or comments, leave them down below.